Well, good evening and welcome to our worship service this Wednesday night at Lyndon Baptist Church. We're glad that you're joining with us tonight. We're going to begin by singing, "My Hope is Built on Nothing Less Than Jesus' Blood and Righteousness, Christ the Solid Rock." Let's join together as we sing and worship Jesus Christ, our solid rock tonight.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in way. He then is all I hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
In Sunday's worship service, we read from Psalm 19. I'd like to share with you portions from the Meditations Now interpretation of Psalm 19 as we prepare ourselves for prayer. Wherever I am, wherever I go, I can sense something of the power of God. The grandeur of the mountains, the vastness of the oceans, the breathtaking wonder of interstellar space, all this proclaims the glory and majesty of God. Even amid the clutter of our cities, built and abused by the hands of men, there are reflections of divine splendor. Heaven's silence or earth's clamor may not be very articulate, yet God's voice can be heard. He makes his presence known throughout the world. Encompass me with your love and grace, that these things may not stand between you and me. O God, these are my thoughts that crowd my heart today. Accept them and respond to them, and enable them to realize anew the security and serenity of your loving presence in my life. I invite you in a moment, few moments of silence, to focus on where you have heard God, where you've experienced God today. And then I will lead us in a time of prayer. Would you bow with me? Gracious Father, we live in a world where there are many distractions, there are many noises, there is much that fills our senses. And we are reminded that you are there, you are present with us. Your voice is heard even in those places where we may not expect it. We give thanks that you are present for all that you have provided for us. As we remember and bring to mind those places where we have experienced you today, we offer the wonder of that experience, the awe and the glory that we experienced, the peace that we found. Our world is filled with many concerns. Concerns for peace in our city, on our streets, across our nation and throughout our world. Voices speaking out, crying out for justice, for hope, for the necessities of life. Lord, may we hear those voices and may we hear your Spirit calling us to respond. We also hear your voice in those quiet moments when we're with someone among our family and friends, our neighbors who are experiencing illness. We lift each one to you, asking that you would bring your healing touch, that you would be present through the hands and the work of the doctors and the nurses and those who are providing care. We know there are far too many in our world who are living with anxiety and depression, whose lives are overcome with fear. Lord, you are there with them. And as we are able, we offer ourselves to journey with them as well as your presence in those moments, in those days. As we go into this evening, we remember, we give thanks. We offer our lives for your service. We pray this in the name of your Son, our risen Savior. Amen.
We sang, "On Christ the solid rock we stand," knowing that if Christ accepts us, if Christ loves us, if Christ forgives us, then we have nothing to fear from the punishment of our sins. We have nothing to fear from God, that we know that we are held safe because of Jesus. So we'll sing together, "I Will Not Be Afraid."
Are underneath me, his arms.
arms uphold me, his love enfolds me, so I'm not afraid. His word will stand forever, his word will stand forever, his truth it shall be my shield and buckler, so I'm not afraid. He will give grace and glory, he will give grace and glory, his cross before me, his banner o'er me, so I'm not afraid. So we go singing onward, so we go singing onward, we're pressing upward, we're marching homeward to Him unafraid.
Viktor Frankl was a German Jewish psychiatrist and doctor in Germany, of course, in the 1930s when Hitler rose to power. Being a German Jew, as a physician, he was prohibited from treating German Aryan patients, and he was limited to only treating patients that were Jewish or perhaps other patients that the Germans had determined were unworthy of being treated or unworthy of being cared for. As the war got closer and as Hitler began to press his Jewish solution even harder, Frankl and his whole family were put into the ghettos, and then eventually they were hauled to the prison camps, the concentration camps. Frankl was working on a book at the time, and he thought, well, maybe one way that I can survive the camps is that I can continue to work on the book that I'm writing. And so he sewed the pages of the book into his overcoat. But of course, as soon as he got on the train, before he got on the train to go to the camp, the Germans removed his luggage as well as his overcoat, and so he lost all the pages of his book. He then determined that the thing that would hold him together, that would keep him surviving in the camps, would be to take care of and watch over his mother and his siblings and his father. But as soon as they got to the camp, his mother and his siblings were separated out from him and taken directly to the death chambers in the camp. So for the longest time, it was simply Viktor Frankl and his father, and his father was already in poor health and was not able after months to survive the rigors of the camp. But being the psychiatrist and psychologist that he was, Viktor Frankl observed what was happening in the camps. And one of the things that he observed was that one of the factors that allowed people to survive the harshest conditions, one of the things that was a factor that was key in helping people to live in spite of the degradation that they had psychologically and physically, was that people who were able to survive were people who could see a meaning and a purpose to their lives that transcended the camps. A meaning and a purpose to their lives that transcended the suffering. And a meaning and purpose to their lives that even helped them to see beauty in otherwise horrible and ugly situations. Sometimes, he said, the prisoners who survived were able to look beyond the walls of the camp, the gates of the camp, And in spite of the ugliness and the sludge and the filth that was in the camp, they could see the beauty of the trees and the flowers beyond, and that gave them some sense of hope that strengthened them in spite of their weakened condition. Now, of course, not everyone who had that kind of hope survived physically. But he said that he discovered that the biggest indicator of whether somebody was going to be able to survive, unless, of course, they were shot or whatever, was this sense of meaning and purpose to their life. A meaning and purpose that was bigger than their life, a meaning and purpose that was bigger than the camps, a meaning and purpose that would continue and extend even beyond their death. Psalm 119 is an extended meditation, if you will, on the Word of God. And for the writer of Psalm 119, the Word of God wasn't just something written down on paper. It wasn't a book. Most people in that day couldn't read, and so most people in that day couldn't pick up a book and read it. The Word of God was something that came to them in hearing. The Word of God was more than just ink and paper. It was a vital force that created life, that sustained life, that brought life into being, and that would and could even end the possibility of life. The Word of God was the presence of God for the psalmist. And so in Psalm 119, the extended meditation on the meaning and significance of the Word of God, I think, is an important psalm for us to spend some time with from time to time. So I want to read for us this evening Psalm 119, and I'm going to begin in verse 86. The Lord exists forever. Your word is firmly fixed in heaven. Your faithfulness endures to all generations. You have established the earth, and it stands fast. By your appointment, they stand today, for all things are your servants. If your law had not been my delight, I would have perished in my misery. I will not forget your precepts, for by them you have given me life. I am yours. Save me, for I have sought your precepts. The wicked lie in wait to destroy me, but I consider your decrees. I have seen a limit to all perfection, but your commandment is exceedingly broad. In those words from Psalm 119, we get the idea, we get the picture that the psalmist had found in this living Word of God, this powerful Word of God that came to him through his hearing and seeped into his very soul, the power and the strength to survive even when he was being pressed, even when his enemies were surrounding him, even when the circumstances of his life sought to destroy him, the psalmist could find that God's word, God's power, God's life-giving strength was able to help him to move through even the hardest of circumstances. And so the psalmist recognizes that it is by the power of the Word of God that he lives in the bad times and even in the good times. You notice the section we read that this evening concludes with those words that said, I've seen the limitation of all human perfection. Whereas even all the good stuff is great, but it has its limits. But the one thing that has no limit, the one thing that exists forever, the one thing that can always be counted on is the life-giving, life-sustaining Word of God. I think the psalmist would have agreed with Frankl and said, yes, the thing that allows us to survive the worst of circumstances is a realization that there is something bigger, that there is something more important, that there is something more powerful, there is something that has existed before we came into being and will be in existence after we pass from this world. And the psalmist found that meaning and that purpose anchored in the word that God has spoken that brought worlds into being, the word that God has spoken that created a garden, the word that God has spoken that has brought redemption to this world, the word that God has spoken in the person of Jesus Christ, who helps us to realize that we don't need to be afraid of the circumstances in which we live, because we are connected to the God whose being always has been and always will be, the God whose word stands firm forever. So in the midst of all of life's trouble and difficulty, we, like the psalmist, can celebrate this strong, enduring word of God. If we read a little bit further in Psalm 119, the psalmist says in verse 97, "Oh, how I love your law! Your commandment makes me wiser than my enemies. I have more understanding than all my teachers. I hold back my feet from every evil way in order to keep your word. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." The word of God shows us the way, even in the most troubling and difficult times of our life. When we can't see a way forward, the word of God illumines the path that we are to trod. We celebrate the Word of God, not just a book with words on a page, but we celebrate that God has and does continue to speak to us, the words of life and the words of hope. Amen and amen.
Well, our final hymn for this evening will be words taken from that passage, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." So let's join together as we sing, "Thy word."
My feet and a light.
And now may the word of God dwell within you richly. And may we sing the joy of the word of God in songs and hymns, in spiritual songs, all the days of our lives. Amen and amen.